Yes, sir.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So today is the part two of the lecture which I started on Friday, and that was regarding paniculitis. So since there have been a few days when I delivered the first lecture, so let's recapitulate those paniculitis which are primarily in the lobules. So we have discussed the septal paniculitis in the previous talk, and we have discussed those lobular paniculitis which are associated with vasculitis. That is the erythema nodosum leprosum and erythema induratum. So today we are going to, and even we discussed that sclerosing paniculitis, that is in which there is sclerosis along with the paniculitis. So now today we are going to discuss from calciphylaxis onwards. So among the lobular paniculitides, among the lobular paniculitides, there is two major classifications. That is the those paniculitides in which there is associated vasculitis, and those in which there is no vasculitis. So in the category in which the paniculitis is not associated with vasculitis, there is again four different types. The paniculitis in which there is little inflammatory infiltrate, the paniculitis in which there is predominantly lymphocytic infiltrate, paniculitis in which there is predominantly neutrophilic infiltrate, and paniculitis in which there is predominantly histocytic infiltrate. So depending upon the type of infiltrate, we divide the lobular paniculitides without vasculitis into four subcategories. In those paniculitides in which there is little or no inflammation, we include sclerosing paniculitis and calciphylaxis. In those in which there is lymphocytic predominance, it is mainly those paniculitis which are associated with autoimmune pathology like dermatomyositis and like lupus erythematosus, and then also the cold paniculitis. And those paniculitis in which the neutrophils are predominant are mainly the enzymatic paniculitides, alpha 1 antitrypsin deficiency, the factitious and infectious type. Then those paniculitis in which there are histocytes, whether granulomatous or non-granulomatous. We include in this the subcutaneous sarcoidosis, the subcutaneous fat necrosis of newborn, then trima neonatorum, admitting a few. Okay, and then there would be cytophagic histocytic paniculitis, subcutaneous paniculitis like T-cell lymphoma. So there are different other type of paniculitis. So generally you should remember that those lobular paniculitides in which there is no vasculitis, they are subclassified into four types that include little inflammation, lymphocytic predominant, neutrophils predominant, and histocytic predominant. So now briefly discussing the remaining types of paniculitides. Calciphylaxis is also called as calcific arteriopathy. It is strongly associated with end stage chronic kidney disease or in renal transplant, particularly those who are diabetic. Most common area involved are the lower extremity and abdomen. Usually it is characterized by a necrotic lesion. Initially it presents as a tender dusky libidoid erythema, and soon after this libidoid erythema converts into a full thickness necrosis and sometime with ulceration as well. These changes then extend deep into the subcutaneous fat. Histopathology is very characteristic. That is, there is mural calcification. Mural calcification means the calcification of the blood vessel wall and intra-arterial, intravascular thrombosis. So two pathologies are typical. That is the intramural calcification of the blood vessels and intravascular thrombosis. Then cold panniculitis. Cold panniculitis is also known as Ex-Fossin disease. It is a form of injury to subcutaneous fat induced by exposure to cold, either by environment or by cold objects applied to the skin like ice packs. Infants are particularly susceptible and can occur in the mucosa, which is called as popsicle panniculitis. It is also known by the term of horse rider's perineo or equestrian panniculitis. Equestrian is related to horse riding. Neonatal and infantile cold panniculitis. Neonates are particularly susceptible to cold panniculitis because subcutaneous fat in newborn is rich in saturated fatty acids, which have high freezing point. So a little decrease in temperature can result in crystallization of subcutaneous fat. Because of the saturated nature of fatty acids in newborn, they are prone to cold panniculitis at lesser temperatures compared to adults. The most commonly involved areas are cheek and the chin, because these areas are rich in subcutaneous fat. And the lesions are usually indolent, indurated, erythematous, or violaceous plaques. Otherwise, the child is healthy and is treated without any, and it becomes all right without any treatment. What happens in adults? The cold panniculitis in adults is mainly a disease of obese individuals, especially obese females. And the common site is lateral aspect of the thigh and gluteal region. The start would be similar to the cold panniculitis in infant, that is erythematous indurated plaque. Soon there will be ulceration and extends into ulceration and later on can cause scarring. Histopathological picture of cold panniculitis is mostly of lobular panniculitis with lymphohistiocytic mix infiltrate. Mind it, this cold panniculitis comes under the category of those panniculitis in which lymphocytes predominate. And there is superficial and deep perivascular and periadenexal lymphocytic infiltrate. And if you remember my talk on histopathological talk on superficial and deep perivascular infiltrates, one of the diseases in which this feature is seen is perniosis. So in perniosis, there will only be superficial and deep perivascular lymphocytic infiltrate in the dermis. But in cold panniculitis, in addition to these changes, there will be lymphocytic infiltrate in the lobules as well. So this is the lymphocytic infiltrate and it is involving the fat lobules, usually at the junction of dermis and subcutaneous fat. These are the lymphocytes and they are surrounding the blood vessel and the blood and the surrounding the fat and the blood vessels and the fat. These are the fats. And since all the panniculitides, especially the lobular panniculitides, there will be fat necrosis. And as I told you last time, fat necrosis manifests as loss of cellular details and loss of nuclei. And there can be different type of fat necrosis. Management of cold paniculitis is not very difficult. It is self-limiting and self-resolving, and full improvement may be seen in few days to months. Prevention of infantile cold paniculitis is achieved by avoiding cold exposure and direct contact with cold objects. For equestrian or horse rider paniculitis, use loose warm clothes when riding with avoidance of tightly fitted clothes. There is sometimes a dramatic response to tetracycline, which is also effective prophylactically. Then this is the lupus paniculitis, which is also called as lupus profundus. And another name is Erlang Kaposi syndrome, because of the two guys who explained this disease. The clinical appearance of most of the paniculitis is similar. Initially, there will be erythema. Later on, it would be a little dusky. Then there will be induration, maybe a little tenderness, followed by ulceration, and later on, atrophy and scarring. So this kind of clinical appearance is seen in all the paniculitis. However, specific site of the paniculitis will help you in making a particular diagnosis, like paniculi, like erythema nodosum on the thighs, cold paniculitis on erythema nodosum on the shins, and cold paniculitis on thighs and buttocks areas. So by the special site, we can just make a diagnosis and further with the clinical history. So as far as the lupus profundus is concerned, it would be anywhere on the body and will present in a similar way. And most of the time, it is seen in patients who are already diagnosed as having SLE or DLE. Later on, depressed scarring may be seen. So the features of the clue to diagnosis of lupus profundus is finding the interface change in the skin biopsy. You can see there is loss of basal layer here. This is only spinous layer. The basal layer is lost. And there is dense lymphocytic infiltrate, perivascular, periadenexal, and then going into the lobules of subcutaneous fat. Here, you can see the dense infiltrate. And the septa are also involved. So lupus profundus can be classified as both septal and lobular paniculitis. But however, the lobular paniculitis is more prominent finding. So this is the lymphocytic infiltrate surrounding the fat lobules. Blood vessels are thickened and hyalinized. So these are all. Now you can see here the hyalinization of the fat. This is the hyalinization is typified by pinkish color. So these are the hyalinized areas. Not going into detail. If we do direct immunofluorescence studies, perilesional skin, we can find the lupus band at the dermoepidermal junction. Lupus band is a mixed kind of deposit of IgG, IgA, IgM at the dermoepidermal junction. Immunohistochemistry studies shows that in lupus profundus, it is not lichen planus, it is lupus profundus. The most commonly T lymphocytes are CD4, which are more as compared to CDA. Lupus profundus is treated almost like SLE or DLE with antimalarials and topical steroids. If active and severely inflamed, short course of oral steroid can be given. Other treatment modalities include dapsone, thalidomide, cyclosporin, methotrexate, intravenous immunoglobulin, azathioprine, and tacrolimus, oral tacrolimus. Severe recalcitrant cases require rituximab or infliximab, the biologics. Then another autoimmune paniculitis. It is dermatomyositis associated paniculitis, which although is less frequent than in LE and systemic sclerosis. Paniculitis is associated with other characteristic cutaneous finding of dermatomyositis. And histopathology, the histopathological findings are similar to lupus paniculitis. That is, there will be an interface change and then dense lymphocytic infiltrate perivascular and in the fat globule. Then pancreatic paniculitis. Pancreatic paniculitis is associated with any kind of pancreatic disease, like acute or chronic pancreatitis and even following ERC. As the pancreatic disease resolves, this paniculitis is resolved. But this is difficult if the cause is some malignancy of pancreas. Extreme tenderness, in addition to the plaques, type of plaques I already explained, is a little hallmark of pancreatic paniculitis. So, although tenderness is seen in most of the paniculitides, but tenderness is a little more in patients with pancreatic paniculitis. Later on, there will be a softer areas of necrosis and draining of the cheesy material from these areas. There will be extra cutaneous manifestations of pancreatic paniculitis as well, like periarticular fat necrosis with concomitant arthritis. There is a triad of pancreatic disease, paniculitis, and polyarthritis, which is called as PPP syndrome. Osteonecrosis may also develop, pleural effusion and serophytes may develop, eosinophilia, and pancreatic tumor is associated with paniculitis, polyarthritis, and eosinophilia. So this kind of extracutaneous manifestation make it important that whenever you find a case or doubt a case of paniculitis, also examine the patient for other autoimmune pathologies, as well as examine the patient joints and lungs to rule out pleural effusion and serositis. So these will be the focus of your clinical examination. Pancreatic paniculitis has generally been attributed to release of pancreatic enzymes like lipases, amylases, and trypsin into the circulation, leading to release of fatty acid from adipose tissue and subsequent fat necrosis. Resistin and leptins are potential markers of extrapancreatic fat necrosis, like in joints. So pancreatic paniculitis will result in fat necrosis and dense lymphocytic infiltrate. This is a typical kind of fat necrosis which we see in pancreatic paniculitis. And these cells turn up into ghost cells, and there was another a disease in which the term of ghost cells is used, and that is pyelomeningitis. So this is the second disease in which the term of ghost cells is being used. So the closer view of this fat necrosis, the ghost cells, you can see there is a loss of cellular details and even loss of nuclei. Then there is dense neutrophilic infiltrate. So in neutrophilic rich paniculitis, we have included the pancreatic alpha-1 antitrypsin, infectious and factitious. So these are the pathologies in which there, in addition to fat necrosis, there will be a neutrophil rich infiltrate. There is another term used here, which is lipophages. Lipophages are macrophages which have ingested the fat. So in macrophages, you will see the fat foamy kind of cytoplasm, which is that of ingested fat cells, like this. These are lipophages. You will see in pancreatic panniculitis. The focus of treatment of pancreatic panniculitis is underlying pancreatic disease. So first, take care of the underlying pancreatic disease. Octreotide, a somatostatin analog, and plasmapheresis are associated with the resolution of pancreatic panniculitis. Treated pancreatic cancer with surgical resection and combination chemotherapy also ameliorate the cutaneous findings. Alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency panniculitis. It is a genetic disorder that manifests as pulmonary emphysema, liver cirrhosis, and rarely cutaneous panniculitis. So the lung findings are seen in pancreatic panniculitis as well as in alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency. In pancreatic panniculitis, it was pleural effusion and serositis, and in alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency, it is the emphysema. And in laboratory, there will be low serum level of alpha-1 antitrypsin. That is the main protease inhibitor in human serum. There will be recurrent episode of painful nodules, frequently ulceration, and sinus formation. This necrosis of subcutaneous fat, dense infiltrate, which is comprising predominantly of neutrophils. The necrosis of connective tissue, reticular dermis, and septa of subcutaneous fat is also seen. The possible mechanism of panniculitis induced by alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency is the lack of interference with various proteases, because we are lacking with antiproteases because of deficiency of alpha-1 antitrypsin. So the proteases leads to activation of inflammatory cascades and lysis and destruction of connective tissue and adipose tissue. Investigation is mainly, there is reduction in alpha-1 globulin on plasma protein electrophoresis and reduced level of alpha-1 antitrypsin. In chronic cases, normocytic, normochromic anemia and hypoalbuminemia is seen. Management by avoiding the trauma and surgical debridement, avoid smoking and exposure to hepatotoxins, and decrease alcohol intake. Treatment is by tetracycline, doxycycline or minocycline in a dose of 200 mg daily for 3 months. The tetracycline has anticholinergic activity. Dapsone is also shown to be effective because it inhibits the migration of neutrophils. So by that, the inflammation will be reduced, pain will be reduced. For severe cases, liver and lung involvement, best option is replacement of alpha-1 antitrypsin by injecting plasma from normal donors. So recurrence after discontinuation of therapy is common. Other interventions like plasma exchange and in rare cases liver transplant is also used. Infective panniculitis is the term used for the panniculitis in which is caused by various infective organisms. And this is again an example of lobular panniculitis with neutrophilic infiltrate. Some degree of immunosuppression is there. Common causes are bacteria. Staph, strep, pseudomonas, nocardia, and sometimes by typical and atypical mycobacteria. Among the fungi, blastomyces, histoplasmosis, cryptococcus, aspergillus, they are common cause of this infective panniculitis. As the classification shows, infective panniculitis is involved mainly have lots of neutrophils, and it involves both the septa and the lobule with widespread necrosis. These are lots of neutrophils, and here you can see the typical Sailor's staring type of fungal hive, fungal colonies, which are due to Cryptococcus neoformans, and also seen in various different kind of infective granulomas, like in tuberculosis, in atypical mycobacteria and defungi. Here there are larger hyphae, which is seen in zygomycosis. Bacterial colonies are seen, different cocci. So in infective panniculitis, you can find, you will undergo, if there is neutrophilic rich infiltrate, you will ask for PS and Gram stain to find, and also AFPs to try to find the exact cause. Treatment consists of appropriate antimicrobial therapy. Surgery may be indicated for isolated cases. Then there is another variety which is called as neutrophilic lobular panniculitis. It incorporates a range of different panniculitis in which fat lobules are infiltrated with neutrophils. In addition to this alpha-1 antitrypsin and pancreatic deficiency, it also includes factitious panniculitis, Sweet syndrome, and even Behçet's disease and bowel bypass dermatosis. Subcutaneous Sweet syndrome, usually Sweet syndrome involves the dermis, and it is characterized by the dermal edema and dense neutrophilic infiltrate in the dermis with or without vasculitis. However, in subcutaneous Sweet syndrome, these changes will be seen in the subcutaneous fat. And there will be erythematous plaques with fever and malaise. Management will be similar to the normal Sweet syndrome. Factitious panniculitis is, or RT, factual panniculitis, result from external injury to subcutaneous fat. The injury can be mechanical trauma, it can be a chemical trauma, it can be a thermal injury. The injurious event may be accidental, purposeful, or iatrogenic, or may be related to some psychiatric disturbance. Extrinsic injury include the cold panniculitis, which we have described before, sclerosing lipogranulomas due to injectable therapies like pentazocine and other habit-forming drugs, and panniculitis due to blunt trauma. This is a paraphenoma, infiltrated plaque with foci of retraction. Factitious panniculitis or paraphenoma associated with fat necrosis with surrounding neutrophilic infiltrate. Again, lipophages, which are the macrophages which have ingested the fat. These are all lipophages. Here lipophage, here lipophage. These are different. The traumatic fat necrosis, because these are typically foreign body type giant cells. Management of factitious panniculitis is by use of antibiotics to cover widespread, because we don't know that how the injury has occurred because of some external, some blunt trauma or a penetrating trauma. So we must give antibiotics. And we must occlude the suspected area so that the individual may not make the condition worse. Panniculitis secondary to cosmetic fillers. These cosmetic fillers, maybe the fillers are infective, or of poor quality, or the technique is defective, which have introduced the infection into the dermis, or the patient himself or herself is not in a very good health. In all such conditions, the fillers can cause infection or infective panniculitis. In such cases, you have to give intralesional steroids. Subcutaneous fat necrosis of newborn, characterized by typically dusky, woody erythema on the back of back and arms and thighs. Here they are crusted and ulcerated lesions on both cheeks. Precipitating factors: hypothermia, hypoglycemia, and perinatal hypoxemia. It is a form of lobular panniculitis in which there will be a dense infiltration of histiocytes within the fat lobule. And along with that, there will be many giant cells. So subcutaneous fat necrosis comes under the heading of lobular panniculitis without vasculitis associated with histiocytic infiltration. Adipocytes are swollen and contain characteristic radial and eosinophilic crystals. These are the radial eosinophilic crystals. These are the giant cells. Complications: hypercalcemia, thrombocytopenia, hypoglycemia, hypertriglyceridemia, etc. Management: lesions resolve spontaneously. Supportive care is required. Hypercalcemia is managed by hydration, dietary restriction of both calcium and vitamin D, furosemide and calcitonin, and biphosphonate. Post-steroid panniculitis: a rare panniculitis which is associated in children and infants with rapid decrease or sudden withdrawal of steroid therapy. Age is from 20 months to 14 years. Clinically characterized by subcutaneous nodules with overlying erythema, and tend to be localized in area which have the greatest accumulation of fat from the steroid therapy. Fat which is induced by the steroid therapy, like face, arm, and posterior neck. It appears 1 to 10 days after sudden cessation of steroids. Histopathological finding is lobular panniculitis with lymphocytes and histocytes and multinucleated giant cell, needle-shaped clefts in lymphocytes and giant cells. No treatment is necessary here. Disappear gradually without residual scars. However, readministration of high-dose systemic steroid and slower and more gradual decrease is followed by faster and rapid resolution of the lesion. Scleremia neonatorum, almost like subcutaneous fat necrosis, but here the induration is very hard, pretty hard induration. It is seen typically in already ill infants, preterm, first week of life. There is diffuse hardening of the skin and subcutaneous. Baby is already severely ill. And main site is buttock thighs, but almost entire skin can be involved. The skin is hard in consistency, non-pitting, cold to touch, and yellow-white in color. Immobility of extremities and face shows a mask-like expression. This is a disease with poor prognosis, and most affected infants die within few days. Needle-shaped crystals are seen in the lymphocytes with chronic granulomatous inflammation. The supportive treatment is what it is required. Rare, the gouty panniculitis. Ulcerated nodules with hyperuricemia. It is an uncommon complication of gout. So you have to be having a very high degree of suspicion, or the patient is a known case of gouty arthritis. This is a histocytosis. आप लोगों को मेरी आवाज आ रही है?
सर आ रही है, लेकिन स्क्रीन
पहले नहीं थी।
मैं स्क्रीन शेयर
नहीं हो रही।
सो दिस इज द लास्ट काइंड, लास्ट पैनिकुलाइटिस, दैट इज साइटोफेजिक हिस्टोसिडिक पैनिकुलाइटिस, कैरेक्टराइज्ड बाय डेवलपमेंट ऑफ एरिथेमेटस subcutaneous nodule containing the lobular infiltrates of macrophages which had phagocyti, phagocytose, the lymphocytes and erythrocytes. And this is a kind of tumor malignancy. It is a lobular paniculitis, and what is typical of this paniculitis is the bean bag cells. Bean bags you must be using in your home. These are actually the macrophages. These are the macrophages which have engulfed the lymphocytes and erythrocytes. So this is also called as cytophagocytosis. This phenomena is also called as cytophagocytosis, in which the macrophages engulf the different inflammatory cells. And this is typical of lipophagic paniculitis. Treatment is by immunosuppression and cyclosporine, and by other anti tumor therapies like tacrolimus, azathioprine, anakinra, and cyclophosphamide and intravenous immunoglobulin. So this brings to end of the paniculitis. Any question from this part or the previous part which we discussed last time?
Sir, मेरा एक question था Dr. Phil, आपसे बात करी।
करो पूछो।
Sir, आपने बताया था कि filler की complication के तौर पर भी paniculitis हो सकता है, और उसकी treatment के लिए हम intralesional steroids देते हैं। तो मेरा question ये था कि intralesional steroids से post steroid paniculitis मतलब वो हो सकता है या फिर
steroid paniculitis जो मैंने आपको describe किया, that is because of withdrawal of high dose of corticosteroids.
Systemic steroids
की वजह से जी, systemic steroids. अगर steroid लगाने से कोई fat पे effect होगा, तो वो fat atrophy होगा. जब हम steroid लगाते हैं intralesional, आपने खुद ये महसूस किया होगा कि जब कभी alopecia areata में आप लगाएं intralesional steroid, अगर आपने high concentration use कर ली तो रिजल्ट क्या होता है, वो जगह धंस जाती है. दैट इज बिकॉज ऑफ फैट एट्रोफी दैट इज इंड्यूस्ड बाय इंट्रालिजनल स्टीरॉयड. इस केस में जो मैं आपको ये कह रहा हूँ इंट्रालिजनल स्टीरॉयड, ये बेसिकली पैनिकुलाइटिस या इन्फ्लेमेशन को कम करे. बल्कि मेरा तो ये कहना है कि अगर पैनिकुलाइटिस लोकलाइज हो, चाहे जिस कॉज का भी हो, वट एवर इज द एटियोलॉजी, इंट्रालिजनल स्टीरॉयड विल ऑलवेज हेल्प. क्योंकि वो ना इन्फ्लेमेशन को देयर एंड देन किल कर देता है. बट इन एडिशन टू इंट्रालिजनल स्टीरॉयड, अदर ट्रीटमेंट डिपेंड्स अपॉन द टाइप ऑफ पैनिकुलाइटिस या हिस्टोलॉजिकल फाइंडिंग. मैंने आपको कुछ जनरल रूल्स बताए थे पैनिकुलाइटिस के. एक तो जनरल रूल आज डिस्कस किया कि तमाम पैनिकुलाइटिस किस तरह प्रेजेंट करेंगे क्लिनिकली, और उनको डिफ्रेंशिएट करने के लिए हमें हिस्ट्री की जरूरत होगी, या if we know that the patient is suffering from a chronic disease which is later on associated with paniculitis, aur agar wo bhi fayda na hua, then we have to resolve to histopathology. Aur histopathology mein bhi हमें कोई फाइंडिंग ना मिली तो फिर हमें जनरल पेनिकुलाइटिस को ट्रीट करना है और दैट डिपेंड्स अपॉन द टाइप ऑफ इन्फिल्ट्रेट विच इज प्रेजेंट. अगर तो इन्फिल्ट्रेट प्राइमरली लिम्फोसिटिक होगा तो गो फॉर स्टीरॉयड्स एंड इम्यूनोसप्रेसिव. हिस्टोसिटिक होगा अगेन द ट्रीटमेंट विल बी द सेम. न्यूट्रोफिलिक होगा तो एंटीबायोटिक्स और एंटी न्यूट्रोफिलिक मेडिसिन लाइक डेप्सोन लाइक कॉल्टिसिन एक्सेट्रा. सो दीज आर द फ्यू जनरल रूल्स विच विल बी एप्लीकेबल टू द पेनिकुलाइटिस. अदरवाइज वी हैव डिस्कस्ड द स्पेसिफिक ट्रीटमेंट्स लाइक इन इरिथिमा इंड्यूरेटम एंटी टीबी इरिथिमा नोडोजम लेप्रोजम in erythema and nodosum in which there is we have to find a cause whether it is sarcoidosis or streptococci. So this is the few points regarding the general rule and rest what ever is the exact cause we will treat about.
ठीक
है,
यानी कि हम लेकिन पेनिक.
हाँ जी पूछो क्या बात, आवाज नहीं आई.
मैंने कहा सर इसका मतलब ये हुआ कि ट्रालिजमल स्टीरॉइड लगाने से फैट एट्रोफी होगी, फैट सेल्स की एट्रोफी हो जाएगी लेकिन पेनिकुलाइटिस नहीं डेवलप होगा, इन्फ्लेमेशन नहीं आएगी वहां पे.
हां इन्फ्लेमेशन क्यों आएगी, एट्रोफी हो जाएगी बस, इन्फ्लेमेशन क्यों आएगी, फैट एट्रोफी कर जाएंगे. और जब हम पेनिकुलाइटिस में स्टीरॉइड लगाएंगे तो जाहिर है स्टीरॉइड का तो रोल एंटी इन्फ्लेमेटरी है, सबसे स्ट्रॉन्ग एंटी इंफ्लेमेटरी एजेंसी स्टीरॉइड है. हम एलोपेशिया एरिएटा में भी स्टीरॉइड इसलिए लगाते हैं कि हम इन्फ्लेमेशन को खत्म करना चाहते हैं, तो वो तो उसका पर्पस एंटी इंफ्लेमेटरी होगा. अगर पेनिकुलाइटिस की ट्रीटमेंट में हम इसको इस्तेमाल करें.
ठीक होगा, थैंक यू सर.
सर आई हैव अ क्वेश्चन इन सबक्यूटेनियस. सर हिस्टोपैथोलॉजिकली कैसे हम डिफरेंशिएट कर सकते हैं सबक्यूटेनियस फैट नेक्रोसिस ऑफ न्यूबॉर्न और स्क्लेरिमा न्यूनेटोरम को?
स्क्लेरिमा न्यूनेटोरम जो है ना वो क्लिनिकल डायग्नोसिस है, मतलब प्री टर्म इल हेल्थ बेबीज हैविंग अ डिफ्यूज इरिथेमेटस एंड लिबिडॉइड एंड वुडी हार्ट स्किन. और जिस तरह मैंने बताया इट विल बी अ लाइफ थ्रेटनिंग कंडीशन. जबकि कोल्ड पेनिकुलाइटिस इन न्यूबॉर्न इतनी कोई बड़ी पैथोलॉजी नहीं है, सेल्फ हीलिंग भी है. अदरवाइज दोनों के अंदर मैंने इन दोनों को क्लासिफाई किया था, मतलब ब्रुक ने दोनों को क्लासिफाई किया था अमंग लॉबुलर पेनिकुलाइटिस विद विदाउट वेस्कुलाइटिस एंड विद हिस्टोसिटिक इन्फिल्ट्रेट. तो हिस्टोसिटिक इन्फिल्ट्रेट भी होगा और क्रिस्टल्स भी होंगे फैट के अंदर. तो इस बेसिस के ऊपर तो आप इन दोनों को डिफरेंशिएट नहीं कर सकते. डिफरेंशिएट करेंगे तो उसकी क्लिनिकल अपीयरेंस पे करेंगे.
ओके थैंक यू सर.
तो पेनिकुलाइटिस जो है ना वो एक डाइवर्स सा सब्जेक्ट है जिसके अंदर बहुत सारी डिफरेंट डिजीजेस शामिल हैं जिनको आपस में कोई रिलेशन नहीं है. लेकिन फिर भी ये जो रोग की क्लासिफिकेशन है जो मैंने दो दफ़ा डिस्कस की है ये बड़ी यूजफुल है. इस क्लासिफिकेशन पे तवज्जो देना है और ज़्यादा मेन चैप्टर जो है ना पेनिकुलाइटिस का वो इसी क्लासिफिकेशन पे ख़त्म हो जाए. मतलब अगर आप क्लासिफिकेशन को अच्छे तरीके से समझ लेंगे तो यू विल बी एबल टू डिफ्रेंशिएट बिटवीन डिफरेंट टाइप ऑफ पेनिकुलाइटिस. और एक बात जो मैंने पहले लेक्चर में की थी वो ये थी कि पेनिकुलाइटिस में जनरली बहुत क्लियर कट डिमार्केशन सेप्टल और लॉबुलर की नहीं होती. सेप्टल के अंदर लॉबुलर और लॉबुलर के अंदर सेप्टल इन्फिल्ट्रेट हो सकता है. तो लेकिन ब्रॉडर टर्म के अंदर हम उनको इन दो क्लासिक कैटेगरीज में डिवाइड करते हैं. तो आई होप कि ये एक डिफिकल्ट टॉपिक था, ये थोड़ा आसान हुआ होगा और आप इसको ना एक दफा पढ़ के अपना रुख से दोबारा ये लेक्चर ले लीजिए. तो थैंक यू वेरी मच. मैं आपको अपनी नेक्स्ट लेक्चर के बारे में फिर कल.
थैंक यू सो मच सर.
थैंक यू सो मच सर.